Hello, I'm Mark Hughes. Welcome to Disability Viewpoints. My very special co-host today is Joan Willshire. Our very special guest for this segment is the Honorable Mayor of Rochester, Minnesota, Kim Norton. Welcome to our show. You may know Kim from the House of Representatives. She served 10 years there and did a great job, and we still keep in touch, as you can see on the screen. And we're here today to talk about the great things going on in Rochester. So I'll let Joan take the first lead question if you'd like to.
Well, this is fantastic. We finally have an autonomous vehicle actually moving to and from, and it's in Rochester. So why don't you just start from the beginning? How did this all come about?
Certainly. So between MNDOT and the University of Minnesota and other folks, they decided to pilot a connected an autonomous vehicle, which is a small shuttle. They wanted to pilot it in a cold climate. And Rochester was working with them and was selected as one of the sites, I believe, White Bear Lake or someplace up in the Twin Cities, maybe working on a second pilot. But we are, we have a shuttle that runs around the city and a multiple block area. And we're piloting it for MnDOT and the U to see how it works.
Cool. So what's the perception? What are the Rochester citizens saying? Yay, we want one of these, or oh my goodness, get that thing out of here.
I would say, reviews are mixed. I think there are a lot of people that see the possibilities that this type of vehicle could have. You asked earlier about, is it handicap accessible? Is it wheelchair accessible? And of course it is.
Yay.
And that makes it, and that makes it very interesting to people, you know, utilizing wheelchairs and walkers and strollers. The ease there, but also because we're home to Mayo Clinic, we have many, many patients that come to visit and that live in the area that also may have other medical devices and what have you that need to get around our community. Particularly the visitors often don't have a car with them, particularly if they're staying for an extended period of time. So the possibilities for, you know, folks with disabilities are huge. Also, people in the community like the idea. It's creative. Mm-hmm. The downside, I will tell you, however, is it's too slow, says the driver of the car behind it. So, you know, it is going 15 miles an hour, and it's hard to explain to people that this is a pilot. It is a learning experience over the next year to find out what works and what doesn't. And so slow and steady goes the shuttle as it works its way without a driver through the community. We have a lot of construction in our downtown area because of Destination Medical Center, which I know you want to talk about later. Mm-hmm. So that construction, and there are barriers on the road, and it has to navigate those. That's kind of an interesting thing for someone to do with a steering wheel. Yeah. But for a vehicle to do it without it, it does mean it goes slower. And I will say there are a few people, I won't name names, that aren't the best of I won't say drivers, but they don't follow the rules quite like they need to. And they pull into the bike lanes and they pull into the shuttle lanes where they don't belong. And sometimes they stop and wait for someone, well, for instance, in a clinic appointment, and the shuttle comes up behind them and waits.
Yeah.
Where if you had a driver vehicle, you would go around, and we do have a way to override that. But those are some of the barriers or some mm-hmm. of the kind of problematic things that we're finding right now is its slowness and it stops sometimes when you don't want it to stop.
You know, so I have a twofold question. Number one is, I believe that as our demographics get older and we humans get older, there's going to be more of a demand for this because it's another mm-hmm. avenue and way to get around. The other thing is, you've only had it since August of this year, of 2021. Mm-hmm. Has the company tested it in winter weather? Because we get some pretty severe winter here. And I just wondered if the company that you got it from has ran all those tests.
I think they've done some, but I think this is it's one thing to test something in a in a research type situation, it's a whole nother thing to test something on the street in real time. Mm-hmm. And so that's what we're doing for them. So I'm sure they've done some preliminary testing, but I've had people ask me questions like, well, it will be driving down the street and maybe it can figure out how to manage through snow, but what if it's snowing heavily and there are big drops of snow or a chunk of snow falls off a tree? Will it recognize that mm-hmm. as snow, or will it think it's another vehicle, for instance, or a person, and will it stop? And so those are the things that we need to really mm-hmm. learn about during the winter. And I will also say one of the other groups of people that that we haven't necessarily talked about here yet, but as we're talking about the disability world, is people with visual impairments that cannot drive, but that want to get around downtown. And it would be wonderful to be able to hop on the shuttle at one corner and have it take you 6 or 8 blocks to the other, you know, another part of your destination. Mm-hmm. And this shuttle is only going in a square, right? So it's for learning. Right. It's not necessarily getting people from one point that they want to go to another like it will in the future. It does start at our food co-op, and it does go over to the corner where Mayo Clinic patients come and go, so, and then back around. But they're not necessarily the stops a person in our community might want to get on right now, but it's learning. So it's trial, it's pilot, and it's hard to sometimes explain that to people.
And I'm sure it's a program that if you have to make a quick stop, an emergency stop, quick, if somebody's crossing, it's probably programmed into the computer.
Oh yes, it's very sensitive to anything. In fact, that's one of the concerns, is that it will be too sensitive, and it will sense snow, or it will sense, you know, something that maybe it shouldn't be sensing, because it is very sensitive. And that's, as I said, that's one of the biggest complaints, that it's too cautious and it's too slow. But certainly, especially in a pilot program, better to be that way than not cautious enough and cause an accident. We
yes,
don't want to see
the senior community, you know, gotten on board, so to speak. The seniors, are they jumping on board?
Yeah, we want people to get on board, because that's the whole idea. We want people to experience mm-hmm. it in the community, people with disabilities and without, people of a variety of ages, moms with strollers, you know, the whole spectrum of the community, so that when the ride is over, and they can do it for free as many times as they want, when they experience it, there's a little QR code that not everybody knows how to use. So there's a little bit of a barrier for some, but if you use that, it's a survey. So after your experience, you can fill out the survey and let the researchers know what worked, what didn't, from that perspective. And then I'm sure they'll ask the community too, at the end of the day, what did we think? I think it would be interesting maybe for you to talk to me again at the end of the winter, right? As we've experienced the winter and what that's like on the shuttle. I will say it's very low to the ground. I do worry, someone suggested, we'll put a snow shovel on the front and just have it clear the snow while it drives around.
Right.
It is very low to the ground, and it may not do as well in heavy, you know, in a really heavy snowfall. We'll have to get a plow out in front of it. So I'll know more, you know, the researchers will know more after the end of the
I have one more question for you. When you have mm-hmm. international travelers who may speak a different language and people that do things by voice command, does it respond to that?
Right now, it has a navigator that stays in there with the shuttle in case there's a problem.
Okay.
So people can feel safe as well. Right. So the language issue, I think it just opens the doors. It lets you on. I think it holds six people and does its route, and then it comes back and opens the door. So there's not a lot of discussion going on. It's more the experience.
Great.
Moving ahead. You have a good point, though. Moving ahead, we do have many languages spoken by the patients at Mayo.
And also, Rochester, Minnesota is one of the first to have this in almost the country. I've never...
What I'm hearing, we're certainly the first in Minnesota with, like I said, I think I heard White Bear Lake as one of the second sites. But
they haven't gotten it yet. They're working on some kind of transportation.
Okay, so they're working on that. And but I'm sure other parts, you know, in warmer climes already have trials going, but of the snowy north, we're at.
Yeah. Well, we want to get to Destination Medical Center next. And
sure.
Boy, I'll tell you, I was about 10 or 11 or 12 years younger even. And we're down at the state office building, and I remember the first day we were down there in the hearing room talking about Destination Medical Center. And I had the honor of testifying on it, not that I had anything to do with it. I'm not saying it for that. But that's where the seed was almost really planted. And to be there and come back maybe 12 years later and see what it's doing and what it's done is just, it's amazing.
People come to Mayo Clinic for health and hope, and sometimes they stay for a long time. And what the clinic found is that the longer people were there in our community, they continued to love Mayo Clinic, but they started liking Rochester less the longer they were there because there wasn't as much to do. And we weren't providing maybe the amenities that someone staying for long-term care was able to provide. And so the concept was, what can we do in that downtown miles, you know, square mile region to improve the experience for staff who are recruited from all over the world, from patients who come from all over the world, to make the experience pleasant and continuing to have that positive experience for the whole length of their stay. And we wanted to do that in a way that was good for our community as well. So we're starting with some public realm and infrastructure projects. And it's been interesting because the issue of disability appropriateness and awareness has come to the forefront on many of the things that have already been built or are in the process of being built, our public realm space. Right. We've gotten rid of curbing. We have curbless streets. We have a more pedestrian and bike friendly area in our downtown Peace Plaza area. But there are challenges in that too. When the community is used to a car centric center, they have to change their behavior to accommodate more people and wheelchairs and bikes when we're making it a person centered street as opposed
to concept.
Car centric, right? Yeah. And so there's a little trepidation right now about we opened up First Avenue, about how fast the cars are going through there and that people are just stepping out because it's meant for that, right? We don't want to have an accident. Yeah. And some of the amenities that we put in, we have a lot of trees, and do the trees cause a hardship for electric wheelchairs, hand-run wheelchairs,
yeah,
baby bring- strollers? Could you, in trying to navigate the area, could you end up in the little area where the root balls are in the tree that have gravel? Could you end up in there rather than staying on the brick surface? And how are we going to manage that? And so we have some challenges ahead. We've done our first big project. Okay. We're learning from that. And there's actually an 18-month evaluation period to go over that. And it's worth noting that everything that was done with input from the disability community all along the way, which goes to show that even with the best of intent and the hard work of a lot of people and people with disabilities, sometimes the way things look on in your head or on paper, when you actually bring them to fruition, they don't always work quite like you thought. So we still have some work to do to make sure that that area is safe for everyone and you don't have a wheelchair, you know, leg falling into a gravel area. We want you to stay up on the sidewalk, right?
Yeah, I'm going to switch over to Joan, let her ask couple questions on this.
Well, it's great to hear that you've involved the disability community, that's for sure. That's what's needed in all projects. I wish everyone would do that. And so, so what do you see some ongoing challenges then with this? Do you feel like you've got a good hold on it? You're going to be able to move forward?
I wouldn't say we have a good hold on it. I think we've started a good process, which is we're calling it co-design. So we are designing everything in our community with the people that it will affect. So we make sure that we involve multiple cultures, multiple abilities, multiple ages, multiple ethnicities and races in a co-design, we're calling it community co-design, who work with the professionals to make the design, to design the realm that we're doing, our public realm. Mm-hmm. I think it's an excellent process, but again, it's not perfect. We found some things that maybe didn't go exactly as we'd hoped. We especially made some benches that were that have levels for people that want to sit, people that want to stand, people that want to roll into on a wheelchair. But again, the placement of the trees was a little problematic. So how are we going to be able to change that moving ahead? So yeah, the process was a nice start, but I think this next step of evaluating what we did and how can we do better next time is going to be really important.
Absolutely. Hey, I want to thank you for being with us today, Mayor Norton, and I hope you'll come back and see us. And probably in the spring, we'll check out and see how the autonomous vehicles did. Mm-hmm. And also, I want to, our big anniversary is coming up pretty soon. And if we do have a party, which I'm sure we might, I want you to be one of my guests to honor.
So I'd be.
I don't know what the plans are yet, but I think we're going to.
Wonderful. So, keep me posted.
All right, I will. Thanks for being with us. We'll talk to you again soon.
The state's first automatic pilot study is going on as we speak in Rochester, Minnesota. These are exciting times in transportation for the state and for the nation as well. So with me today to discuss some of these hot topics is Tara Olds from the Minnesota Department of Transportation. My name is Joan Willshire, and I'll be your co-host for this segment. Well, welcome, Tara.
Thank you, Joan. Thanks for having me today.
Great. Well, as I said, these are exciting times right now in Minnesota in particular, because we have our first pilot of the autonomous vehicle.
That's true. It's very exciting for us here. We have our autonomous shuttle down in Rochester, Minnesota, down by the Mayo Clinic, and we're really excited to get it out on the road, have folks ride it and share their experiences so they can help shape the future of transportation here in the state.
Great. Well, before we jump into the specifics of what's going on in Rochester, why don't we talk a little bit about the connected and automated vehicle? You're the acting executive director for the CAV, the short acronym for the division within the Minnesota Department of Transportation. Tell us briefly what CAV is, what some of the goals are, and then how this first autonomous vehicle pilot fits in with all of this.
Definitely. So when we say connected and automated vehicles, people sometimes are a little bit confused, not really sure what that means. And most people, when they think of connected and automated vehicles, are actually thinking of self-driving or driverless vehicles. But connected and automated vehicles is so much more than just that. So I like to separate them between the two. We have connected and automated. And connected vehicles really use technology to communicate to each other, to other things, to traffic signals, to signs, and they can obtain data from other sources as well. This really helps allow for some enhanced safety as well as potentially improving traffic flow. And then we get to the automated side, and that's where we can use technology to do different types of operations of a vehicle, like steering, accelerating, or braking, and that can have varying levels of human input. So some of these vehicles still require humans to actually monitor the roadway, while others maybe require no human intervention at all. So kind of differing levels of automation as well. The automated vehicles really use sophisticated computer programming, cameras, sensors, and a number of other different things to take over those responsibilities. So when you combine these two together is where you get that connected and automated vehicles. And it really is a term that we're broadly using to encompass both connected vehicles as well as automated vehicles.
Wow. It seems like a mouthful, but it all makes sense when you frame it in that way. Now, with Rochester, it started, late summer in August, the first pilot?
That is correct. Yeah, the vehicle, we have two driverless, highly automated shuttles that are on the roads in Rochester. They carry 6 seated belt passengers at one time. We were able to start operations here late summer, early fall. And we've been carrying over 1,000 passengers to date. So it's been great. Had variety of folks be able to share their thoughts and experiences. And it's really helping us understand how connected and automated vehicle technology works here in Minnesota. A lot of technology has been tested elsewhere around the country, but not a whole lot in those cold weather climates like we have here.
Right. And so you're just itching for the first snowstorm, I bet, right?
I don't know about that, but it'll definitely be telling to see how the vehicles function. We know that there'll be a lot of lessons learned. We know that they're not going to work completely 100% perfect at all times. We've already done some previous testing in 2017 and 2018 with the same company of the technology provider EasyMile. And we've learned a lot since then, and we know that they've been able to make a lot of advancements, but we know we have a really long way to go. One of the things that's really important for the state of Minnesota not just the DOT, but all of the enterprise agencies in the state, is to build a future of transportation that is safe, equitable, accessible, efficient, healthy, and sustainable. And we really see this as a way to help us get there. We want to make sure that if we're going to provide transportation options in part of our transportation system, that it can be used all year round and not just potentially during those summer months that we are going to be missing here shortly.
Right, right, exactly. So this is fabulous here that you're looking at all the different areas, not only from the vehicle and the roads, but then the connecting piece, the to and the from.
Yeah, definitely. So right now the route goes about 1.5 mile loop in downtown Rochester. It mm-hmm. connects from the Mayo Clinic, the Gonda building, down to the People's Co-op. So only two stops on the route that we have right now, but really just an opportunity for folks to expose themselves to the technology, interact with it, and get a chance to ride it. We know that in the future, if we were looking at any future deployments or long-term sustainable routes, we would want to make sure that we would be much more strategic, working with the community to understand what those exact needs are, as well as with other transit and transportation providers. Right now, we're really just looking at that as, how could you use it? Help us understand so that as we continue to look at advancing it in the future, we allow the people here in Rochester, whether they live there, visit, or are just stopping through, the opportunity to weigh in.
Have you seen people with disabilities or seniors using the shuttle?
We have. We've had a number of folks that have also completed our pre and post ride survey, which has been a great way for us to be able to get some feedback that's documented. But we also have onboard operators that are able to have really good conversations with folks. Sure. Some folks currently have said that they really appreciate the ability to be able to ride it in a wheelchair. There mm-hmm. is a wheelchair ramp as well as wheelchair tie downs that are in compliance with Minnesota state statute. And we've mm-hmm. worked with State Patrol for that. There's Braille on some of the buttons. We also have audio safety messages that is spoken in English, but we also were able to put it written in English, Spanish, Somali, and Arabic. And then we also have some trolley bells that hopefully are allowing folks maybe with other disabilities that are outside of the vehicle to know that it's coming through, because as an electric vehicle, it is very quiet. And oftentimes maybe folks don't hear it. So acknowledging that there's probably still other things that we can do to enhance it and make it even more accessible, more desirable, and more accommodating are the things that we'd love to make sure we can ask folks and be able to share with our technology providers as well.
So how fast does this shuttle go?
It doesn't go very fast. So that's something that I think a lot of folks are often kind of shocked by. The vehicle's programmed to go at a maximum speed about 10 to 15 miles per hour. And wow. we're at about only 10 miles per hour in this environment. There's a lot of traffic. There's a lot of pedestrians. There's a lot of people rolling in wheelchairs. There's a lot of people on bikes. And so with the environment that's down there, that's what we have it around set for a maximum speed. So you will notice that it maybe goes a little slower than the rest of traffic, but it's not necessarily impeding traffic because of the short distance that it's going in that circular route as well. So only 10 miles per hour, a little slower, but it definitely can help you get from one place to another and hopefully can serve a transportation purpose in the future that we're asking folks to help us understand what that could be.
So what are some of the goals of CAV in the future? I mean, this is just the first pilot. Are you looking to do more?
We're always looking to do more, whether it's going to be demonstration pilots or other different projects. We really want to make sure that we're working with communities to address their needs of today, but also those needs of the future. Some of them we don't even know yet, but we're going to help with the community's help, hopefully explore those. We want to make sure that we're safely testing and deploying this type of technology. Like I mentioned, a lot of it hasn't been tested in cold weather. A lot of it hasn't been tested in snowy conditions. And we know we're going to have a lot to learn, and we know there's probably going to be a lot of opportunity for improvements as well. We also know we want to make sure we're promoting access for all transportation users. And if there's issues that we experience along the way, we want to make sure that we're able to address those. We know that there's different ways technology can help address equity and address accessibility issues that we see today. And so we'd like to explore that as well. Other things that we're looking at too is how can we look at the workforce in Minnesota? When we think of CAV, we often just think of transportation and of vehicles.
Right.
But the impact's going to go far broader than just the Department of Transportation. So we partner with the Department of Employment and Economic Development to look at maybe how workforce might be changing, whether it's the needs or upskilling different employees, to make sure that we're creating a future that works for those that might be impacted in ways that we might not currently know.
Wow. It's so exciting. I just can't wait for this to be more widely dispersed, and exciting to see what more pilots you might have down the road. What would you say to people with disabilities in particular who might be watching this show on what they can do to help promote this and to really get it become a conversation of everyone out there?
That's a great question, Joan. You know, first I'd say if you live in Rochester, might have the ability to travel to Rochester, we'd love for you to ride it. I do will note that our planned hours of operation are 9 a.m. until 3 p.m. Monday through Friday and 9 a.m. until 5 p.m. on Saturdays and Sundays, not operating on the holidays. Got to give those operators a little bit of a break. But we say planned hours because it's not always going to be running. We're going to have some interruptions and things like that. So if you live in the area and you're able to get to downtown Rochester, we want to hear what you think of it. We want to hear what you think of it riding it, but also maybe as another riding in another vehicle in downtown, or as a pedestrian or someone in a wheelchair. If you're not able to get down to it, we also would love to hear what you think about maybe future opportunities for this mm-hmm. type of technology. So we'll be looking at doing other engagement opportunities in 2022, hopefully being able to go to a little bit more in-person events and talk to folks to understand what are the challenges that they see today and what are the opportunities they'd like us as a state to start exploring with some of the local partners as well.
Why don't you give the website where people can learn more about CAV and other fun, exciting things that will be coming down for autonomous vehicles?
That is a great question. So our project for down in Rochester is called the MedCity Mover, and that has a link, or that website is medcitymover.com, and that'll redirect you to our MNDOT website. And if mm-hmm. you go to our MNDOT website, that address is a little bit trickier. So if you Google MNDOT CAVX, that'd probably be the easiest way to get you to our website, as opposed to me going through all the backslashes and such.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Tara, for coming on here and sharing all the exciting news about autonomous vehicles coming to a road near you in Minnesota.
Well, thanks for having me, Joan. And if folks have any questions, feel free to reach out to us as well. Our contact information for myself and our office is on the website, and we'd love to have conversations with any of your viewers that might want to discuss this further. So thanks for having me today.
Great. So thanks so much.
For Joan Willshire and the entire team here at SPNN, I'm Mark Hughes. Thanks for watching Disability Viewpoints. We'll be back soon. Bye now.